Good morning. I am Dr. D. Vasudevan, Professor in NIT, Department of Mechanical Engineering. I am going to deliver a lecture on Total Quality Management and Introduction. The basic definition of TQM, that is Total Quality Management, is a philosophy that involves everyone in an organization in a continual effort to improve quality and achieve customer satisfaction. When we straight away begin with the definition of TQM, understanding is a little bit difficult, because before going into the concept of total quality management, you are supposed to know what is meant by quality and what is meant by customer satisfaction. Quality is a very, very familiar word, and this word is often known to everybody, but they will not know the basic and the implied meaning of quality. To understand the implied meaning of the quality, we have to go for a formal definition for quality. That is, quality as defined by the quality guru Zuron is fitness for the purpose. And it is also defined by another person, Professor Deming, as customer satisfaction and beyond. And ISO 9000 give a very clear cut definite definition, that is totality of the all features and the characteristics of a product or service that bears on its ability to meet the stated and implied needs. But if you go through these three basic and the world approved definitions of quality, understanding is a little bit difficult, because what we commonly recollect when we say quality is, it is different. We say that it is something a costly product. If I say a quality car, it will be what we come across in a Mercedes-Benz car. But here the quality is, as inferred by the TQM, is a little bit different. It says very precisely fitness for the purpose. If any car serves its purpose, then it is a quality car. If you take any product, if you take a pen, when it serves its purpose, it is a quality pen. That is what propounded by Zuron. This definition is not only applied for products, you can also apply the same definition for any service also. A practicing doctor cures a patient and he is a quality doctor. So whenever any service or the product serves its purpose, then it is a quality product or quality service. That is what advocated by Zuron. Deming, another professor, Edward Deming, had little bit more in-depth meaning for quality, that is customer satisfaction and beyond. Whenever a product fetches customer satisfaction, beyond means customer delight. So here we are coming across with two similar wordings. That is, one is customer satisfaction, and in that definition he says that beyond means here it is customer delight. So here you should know the difference between both customer satisfaction and customer delight. The customer satisfaction is one which fetches satisfaction in the minds of the customer. A customer delight is something little more than customer satisfaction. This can be well understood by giving a practical example. You are going for an industrial trip, or if you are going for a trip in a vacation, and you are expecting a pocket money of 5000 rupees from your parents. And if you get 5000 rupees from your parents, you will get customer satisfaction. Suppose if your parent, before you asking for money, if your parent gives you 10,000 rupees instead of 5,000, you will be much delighted than satisfaction. Your mind will get delighted, and that is called as customer delight. So when a customer gets what he want, he will get customer satisfaction. And if a customer gets more than what he want, then he will get customer delight. So whenever a product delivers the need for of a customer, then it is a quality product. Whenever a product or service delivers more than the requirement of a customer, then also the product or a service is a quality product or quality service by Edward Deming. And this ISO 9000 is a total comprehensive definition, like something like in legal terms definition for quality. This fitness of purpose, customer satisfaction and beyond, these are our colloquial and formal way of defining. Even a common man will understand what is a customer satisfaction and beyond. A common people will understand what is a fitness for the purpose. But here the ISO 9000 definition is something totality covering everything in a legal platform. So it is a comprehensive definition. What it says is totality of all features, that is features by the product or service, and the characteristics of the product or service that bears on its ability to meet the stated and implied needs. So the simple meaning of this three line is, when a product or a service delivers its needs, delivers the expectation of the customer, then it is a quality product or service as far as ISO 9000 is concerned. So these three definitions give a internationally approved explanation and a definition for quality. In total quality management, you should understand what is a quality, and you should understand what is a quality in its right terms, right meaning. Then only you can understand the total concept of total quality management. Now let us revert back to the definition of total quality management. Total quality management is a philosophy. It is not a method. It is a total philosophy. It is not a method. It is a group of methodology, a group of behavior, and which involves everyone in an organization in a continual effort to improve quality. Here quality means improving the customer satisfaction. Quality means delivering the purpose. And by improving the quality, by practicing TQM, we are going to achieve customer satisfaction. So quality here creates, delivers customer satisfaction, and beyond that also. This is the comprehensive definition for total quality management. This total quality management is a very nascent subject. A nascent subject means it is a newly formed subject. If you take the subjects like thermodynamics, if you take the subjects like physics, chemistry and all, they are in the world for the past 200 to 300 years. But this total quality management is a very new subject, and a formal TQM was evolved only in the latter part of 1980s. If you take in 1980s, when you study quality, you will be coming across with a paper called statistical quality control. This is statistical quality control and all are something like a stepping stones for total quality management. This total quality management as a formal subject had evolved only after 1985. But it is a very, very important subject, and this is a common subject to all engineers. If you take every stream, it may be a civil engineering, or it may be a mechanical engineering, or it may be a computer science engineering, that in all industries, as on date, TQM is implemented. Every engineer is practically, every manager in an engineering company is practically practicing TQM. Because of that only it attains its importance. And its importance can be further reviewed in the historical review. And another important fact about the TQM is, it is the reason behind the success of all Japanese industry. The Japanese industry are not only successful by their technical or technological advancement. If you take a technological advancement, the US industry is much ahead of Japanese industries. The Japanese industries taste success because of TQM implementation than because of technological advancement. That is the fact. Now, Asante, entire world, including European countries, American countries, East Asian countries, and South Asian countries, Australian industries, everyone is learning and practicing total quality management. This is the important. Suppose if an entrepreneur or if a manager want to conduct the show Asante successfully by facing the international competition, they have to know TQM, they have to understand TQM, and they have to implement TQM. Now let's move to dimensions of the quality. Quality we had defined already. We had already defined quality as fitness of purpose, or something which delivers customer satisfaction, and something which delivers customer delight. But you want to quantify anything. If you see anything scientifically, we are having a habit of quantifying it. We are having a habit of deriving a mathematical formula or an equation so that to give dimensions. And if you take dimensions of equality, the small thing which explains is this: quality is P by E. Here P is, Q is quality, P is performance, P is performance, and E is expectation. When the performance is more than expectation, when the performance is more than expectation, what is becoming is, this Q becomes more than one. If the performance is more than expectation, this Q becomes more than one. Then only we are getting quality product or quality service. When the expectation is more than the performance of the product or service, the Q will become less than one, and your product or service will become a less quality product or service. So, in order to quantify, we have to quantify the expectation of the customer. We have to quantify the performance of the service or the performance of the product. If you are able to quantify the performance of a product or a service, and if you are able to quantify the expectation of the customer, then we can quantify quality. When the quality is more than one, then the product or service will be a quality product. If the quality is having a value less than one, and we may call that as having under quality, or the quality is little bit less than the expectation. Next is dimensions of the quality. Now I want to recollect what we mean by dimension. Naturally, if you take a graph, in the graph sheet we are having two dimensions. An x-axis will be referring one dimension, the another y-axis will be referring and another dimension. So we will be getting a plane, something like this wall or like this blackboard. So the point in the wall, you take this, this point in the wall can be defined by two dimensions, that is corresponding x-axis value and the corresponding y-axis value. Then we call that as coordinates. By stating that the coordinates, we can define the exact position of this point. So a plane is having two dimensions. Likewise, we want to explain the dimensions of the quality, because it is having many dimensions. Let us list what are all the dimensions. These dimensions are performance, futures, conformance, reliability, durability, service, response, aesthetics, reputation. So clearly, Asante, we are having 9 dimensions to indicate a value for a quality. But because of this nine dimensions, what we infer mathematically is, if a point or if a parameter is having nine dimensions, it will be a very complex parameter. That is why achieving or configuring or designing a quality product is also a complex phenomenon. Because a point on a plane, it is having only two dimensions, so very easily we are giving its coordinates. By specifying x and y values, we are very easily specifying the position of a point on a graph sheet or a point on a plane. But this quality is having nine dimensions, because of that the quality becomes very complex to define, very complex to specify, and very complex to obtain. So now let us define each dimensions, because if we know what are all the dimensions in detail, then only we can completely and comprehensively understand what is a quality is. The first one is performance. If you take a product, the performance is its intended purpose. If you take a car, if you take a car engine, the performance is the power delivered by the engine for the fuel input. It is a performance. In a informal wordings, a fuel consumption of a car is a performance measure. The fuel consumption of a two-wheeler is a performance measure. That is basic purpose of any product. If you take a doctor, the doctor's ability to diagnose the disease and giving the treatment, it is performance. If you take an engine, the ability to deliver the power for the given input of fuel, it is performance. Likewise, depending upon products, depending upon services, the performance is, we can explain the performance. But basically a performance is basic purpose of any product or a service. The second one is features. Over and above the basic things, we will be having added features in all products. You take a car, in a car we are having an air conditioner. Now we are having a climate control. Now we are having a rear view camera. All these things are features. If you take a ordinary pencil, in the head of the pencil we are having an eraser. It is a feature. So it is second dimension. The basic for a pencil is the pencil has to write. It is the basic performance. But the same pencil, in the head we are having an eraser fitted with it. Then it becomes a feature. So the secondary purpose a product delivers is a feature. It is an another dimension. Third one is conformance. Conformance is, nowadays we are having specifications to all products. If you take your car has to adhere to the government pollution norms. It should pass through Bharat Stage 2, Bharat Stage 3 pollution norms. If you go to Europe pollution norms you have to satisfy. So conformance to satisfying the norms put by the regulatory bodies. That is another dimension. Then fourth one is reliability. Reliability is a very big area. Nowadays we are having a reliability engineering as a course in IME. The reliability is the ability of any product to deliver its intended purpose whenever it is warranted. The definition is a little bit complex. So I again repeat it. Reliability is ability of any product to deliver its intended purpose whenever it is warranted. That is it. Basically the reliability is ability to deliver, intended purpose, not only this, and also whenever it is warranted. Here warranted means whenever it is wanted. That is, this can be, the reliability can be very easily understood by an example, practical example. You take a pen, the purpose of the pen is, you have, when you write, it should write. You are taking a pen and you are writing it. The pen writes. The pen is a reliable pen. For this also we are having a quantification. 100 times you are taking the pen, all the 100 times the pen writes, so its reliability is 10%. 100 out of 100 it is working. So it is reliability. Now with this practical example, you read this definition. Reliability is the ability to deliver its intended function whenever it is warranted. Whenever if you start the bike, if you are having a kick-starting bike, whenever you kick, the bike starts. One time you are kicking, the bike getting started. 100 times you are kicking, all the 100 times the bike starts in single kick, then reliability is 100%. This is the meaning. I hope that now you will be understanding what is a reliability is. We, in some machines, we always want 100% reliability. The typical example for that is a revolver. Whenever you shoot, it should shoot. If you take an aero engine, we want 100%. Whenever it takes off, it should take off. Whenever you land, it should land. Otherwise, there is no purpose for that machines. So reliability, when you go for some particular purpose machines, it is having a greater importance. One such application is aero engine. The same way, the reliability is also a dimension for any quality product or any quality service. Whenever a doctor gives a treatment, the patient should get cured. Then only a doctor is a reliable doctor. So this reliability is applied not only to the products, it is also applied to services. Next comes a durability. So if we are buying a product, for any product there is a duration, there is a useful lifespan. You take a refrigerator, for a refrigerator the useful lifespan is 10 years. So when you buy a refrigerator, the refrigerator should work for 10 years. Then it is having a durability. For a car, the durability is 15 years or 2 lakh kilometers. Depending upon the car companies, it changes. If you go for a Suzuki made car, it's 2 lakh kilometers. If you go for Tata Motors, it is 1.5 lakh kilometers. When you go for a Toyota vehicles, it is 3 lakh kilometers. When you go for your Volkswagen, it goes around 5 lakh kilometers. All German make cars, the intended life is 5 lakh kilometers. So like that, your product is, quality of your product is also measured by its durability. So durability will change depending upon the type of the product, depending upon the maker's promise. Say Suzuki, they are promising only 2 lakh kilometers. But if you take a Toyota, they are promising for 3 lakh, and some 5 vehicles, they are promising for 5 lakhs. So whatever they promise, that is the durability. That durability, that product should serve. Then only we can say that that product is having 10% durability. Next comes service. A service is having a broad spectrum of meaning. If you take service, we can talk about the service even for a few hours. But here, as far as the basic dimension of quality is concerned, the service is whenever a customer who purchased the product wants the assistance of the manufacturer, And if he gets that assistance immediately, service is fulfilled. The assistance may be in the way of attending a fault. The assistance may be in the way of clarifying a doubt. The assisting in the may be in the way of having a discussion. So whenever a customer wants the assistance from the manufacturer, if the manufacturer provides that assistance, then service is fulfilled. So that the service is also a dimension of a quality. Then response. So customer complaints, if a customer complains, if the manufacturer responds, not solving, he is giving a complaint, not necessary all the complaints can be solved. But all the complaints should be responded by the manufacturer. That is also a dimension of equality. Then comes aesthetics. It is subject to many things. A car, even if you have all those things, if your car is not good looking, you will not buy the car. And in some products, aesthetics will be having paramount importance. You take a jewelry. Your jewelry is bought because of the aesthetics. You take a diamond ring will be 2 lakh rupees. If the diamond ring is not good looking, people will not buy it. So it depends upon the product. But it is not in the case of the doctor. If the doctor is not good looking, it is not the case that we will not get good treatment. There the case is different. But generally speaking, for many specific products, we demand aesthetics. Aesthetics may be in the name of good packaging, or it may be in the name of good merchandising, or it may be good outlook, good way of delivering the product. You take as far as restaurants is concerned. In the restaurants, they are selling the product. They are selling the foodstuffs. If you go to KFC, they deliver the foodstuffs in a nice manner. They will give you a good tray, a good packing. They will do good garnishing for the food. All those things improve the aesthetics. That aesthetics also plays a major role, and it is also a major dimension in some group of products and group of services. Then comes a reputation of the manufacturer or the reputation of the seller. Say, sometimes these reputations, because of the reputations, the customer will blindly get the customer satisfaction. The manufacturer will be a very big company. Say, if the Tata Group is delivering jewelry, it is a practical example. If you take in India, Tata Group, they started manufacturing and selling the jewelry only in the past 15 years. But if you take in all the cities throughout India, their market share is nearly 15-20% of the total jewelry market. All other people who are there in the market for the past one century, they are only sharing other 80%. But this Tata, even though he is a new entrant in the jewelry market, within a span of 1-2 decades, he is able to capture 10-15% of the total jewelry market in India. That is a typical example how a reputation plays a role in terms of the dimensions. Okay, these are the 9 dimensions of quality. In totally, we have to satisfy all these 9 dimensions if you want to deliver a good product or a good service. But it is a little bit tricky because every product will be having an optimum requirement of each dimensions. If you take a car, average car or a low budget car, people will worry about performance much more. But if you go for a luxury car, they will see the features. And if you want a car for military applications, they will look for reliability. A common man will want a car which is durable. Everyone will want good service. Everyone would want good response. And aesthetics, it is also a major. And the reputation of the manufacturer is also important. So we have to give a proper mix of these dimensions to deliver a quality product which fetches customer satisfaction and beyond. So this is a $1 million question. What is the right mix? If you are able to find out your right mix for every product, then your product will be a successful product in the market. So you have to optimize the requirements. That will be coming by proper understanding as well as proper experience of the market. Next. We want to, next title is quality planning. Now, before quality planning, one aspect you should know, quality is not static. Quality is dynamic. Take for example, a fashion. Fashion is a right example where you can understand the meaning of quality in its right sense. If you take in 1980s, the fashion, you see a film which was made in 1980s, and there you can, if you watch the shirt of a hero, the shirt will be having a different, he will be wearing a shirt with very big collar, that type, and he will be wearing a tight fitting shirt. That is the fashion in 1980s. Now after 3 decades back, in 2011, you see a film. Today's hero will be wearing a shirt with a short collar. So in 1980s, a big collar is a quality product. In 2010, a shirt with a short collar will be a quality product. In 1980, a big collared shirt will fetch customer satisfaction of the customer. In 2010, a small collared shirt will fetch the customer satisfaction for the customer. So from this, what we infer is, quality is not static, it will change with time to time. So by understanding that the quality, basic definition you know what is quality, you know what is customer satisfaction, you know what is customer delight, and you know the basic definitions of the quality, and also you know quality is a dynamic phenomena and a dynamic feature. With all these in these things, you have to go for the next title called quality planning. Quality planning is essential for incorporating changing customer needs into the product to retain or improve the rank of the product. So basically why we want to quality planning is, we want to incorporate customer requirements into the product. It is also applied for service. In the case of service also, we have to incorporate customer requirements in the service. For that, the process is called as quality planning. The basic definition I repeat again for quality planning is, it is incorporating the changing customer needs into the product to retain or improve the rank of the product. Here the meaning of the rank of the product means the product's market share in the market. The next is, for quality planning, what we have to do? How we have to do quality planning? The essential steps of the quality planning are, one is, you have to establish what is quality goals. So the first step is, what we want to establish in the product, what is the quality requirement of customer, that is quality goals. Then you identify which are all the quality goals which impacted much to the customer, that is second step. The third step is, you discover customer needs. The fourth step is, you develop corresponding product feature. Then from the corresponding product feature, you decide corresponding manufacturing process features, that is fifth. Then you produce process controls and you transfer it to the shop floor operations. This is the steps what you want in quality planning. Next is, we are coming across with Zurond's quality planning roadmap. Because what we had seen in the last slide is little bit abstract when you study, because it is having a generalized formality. Generally, this is applicable for doing quality planning for any product for in or for any service, you can follow this this steps. But now at this stage, if you read through it, it will be a little bit abstract and it will be a little bit confusing. But to have a further explanation, Zurand had given a very good designed quality planning roadmap. Let's go through it. This is the Zurand's quality planning roadmap. Here he classifies into two categories. One is activities, another one is outputs. And he gives by a step by step, like a flow diagram. If you follow this flow diagram, you can do quality planning of any product or any service. Now let's see what is there. One is establish quality goals. That is activity. Output is list the quality goals. Then from the list, identify the goals that impacted the customer. Then you list the customer. Now at this point, you should understand one thing. We cannot design a product which satisfy all the customers. That is the world known fact. We cannot design a single product so that a single product satisfy all the group of customers. That is very, very difficult. It is impossible. For that I can say, you take a detergent cake. A detergent cake is, one cake price is 50 rupees. That is one company is delivering. Another cake is 3 rupees. Another company is delivering. That 3 rupee detergent cake is also successful in the market. A 40 rupee detergent cake is also successful in the market. Why? Because 40 rupee detergent cake is catering to one class of customers. And this 2 rupee or 3 rupee detergent cake is catering to another group of customers. So there are different group of customers. And your product should aim at some particular group of customers only. You cannot design a single product which satisfy entire customer group. That is very, very difficult. That is impossible. Because of that fact only, many companies are delivering many models. If you take an automobile manufacturers, you take a Suzuki Motors, Maruti Udyog, they are coming out with 6 or 7 models right from 3 lakh rupees to 25 lakh rupees. Why? Because for each model is concentrating on different group of customers. So when you go with the second step, identify the goals impacting the customer, you have to list the customer. Then after the listing the customer, you have to, from which group of customer wants your product, you have to identify. Then particularly, what is the requirement of that group of customer, that is discovering customer's need. Then you list the customer needs. Then from the customer needs, you translate the customer needs into product features. That is, customer requirements will be in the layman's language. You have to translate that customer requirements into product features of your product. Then that product features should be translated into product design. Then from the product design, you develop corresponding process features. From the process features, you do process design. From the process design, you do process controls and transfer that controls to the operations. Then you process the ready to produce process you deliver. This is a quality plan roadmap delivered by Zurand's, and it is as on date it is followed in all industries. In all Japanese industries, while they have quality planning, they follow Zurand's quality planning roadmap. Even you can do for planning any service product plan or any service planning or quality planning of any product, you can follow this Zurand's quality planning roadmap. Then comes, in quality planning, our traditional organizations, our traditional organization structure. This is our regular traditional organization structure. And GM will be there, staffs will be there, many departments will be there, under them some departments will be there. Like that, this is our traditional organization structure. In the traditional organization structure, act as a barrier to fast quality planning. Because as on date, because of globalization, as on date, because of competition, fierce competition in the market, every company has to come out with developed new products often. If you take a mobile, every month they have to deliver new products, otherwise your company will fail in the market. If you take a mobile company, mobile manufacturers, every month they are delivering new products. Advanced, they give advanced products. If you take an automobile manufacturer, every year they are coming with advanced models of the cars. So, quality planning should be done with a greater speed and with a greater precision. Your quality planning should be accurate. For a successful quality planning, our traditional type of this type of organization is not good. It creates failure. Because in our traditional organization, the communication, interdepartmental communication is very, very slow and it is very, very low also. A person in a service department will never communicate with the planning department because of this type of organization. You see, he will be only communicating with his head. From his head, he will only communicate with the general manager. He will never communicate with the planning people. He will never communicate with the engineering people. If you take service people, will never communicate with planning people, engineering people, like that. So, here quality planning takes more time, as well as quality planning is not much effective in traditional type of organization. That is put forward by Zurlon. And he advocates an another type of ideal organizational structure where quality planning is much more efficient. This type of organization structures, this type of organization structure, there is interdepartmental communication is much, much effective. Each department shares its information with all other departments. Each department is having communicational channel, communicational link with all other departments. Because of that, here quality planning will become efficient. The time taken for the quality planning is also much less. So Zurlon advocates this type of ideal organization structures for effective quality planning. But this is type of organization structures is having its own drawbacks in other activities. Zurlon only introduces this structure as an ideal organization structure for a better, more suitable, fast quality plan or quality planning process. But for some other activities, it may be a hindrance. This type of organizational structure, it may be a hindrance. Next concept is cost of quality. Because we are having a basic belief, whenever a product is having a quality, it is costly. This is a common belief of every individual. But it is not so. If you understand properly what is your quality is, you will not say that quality is costly. Because quality is not costly. Quality is one which fetches customer satisfaction. Quality is one which delivers customer joy. Quality is one which delivers fitness of the purpose. So here there is no question of cost is coming. Here the question of giving satisfaction. Here the question of delivering the purpose. So they are only coming. So here cost does not come. But basically everyone's mindset is, if something is having more quality, it is more costly. In some cases, people is also of having a mentality like that costly products are quality products. That is also not the case. Sometimes costly products will not have quality because it fail to fetch customer satisfaction. Now let's see the concept of cost of quality. Actually, cost of quality had come into the minds of the all industry peoples only after the publication of a book called as Quality is Free. Quality is Free by one Mr. Philip B. Crosby. He had said that he had published a book with a title Quality is Free, because quality is delivered because of a mindset among the all stakeholders. Here we are not spending more money. For example, you are preparing an assignment. A typical example to make you more about quality. There are two students. One student is preparing a good assignment, good handwriting, with a lot of reference from library and websites. He prepare a 5-page assignments, which gives very good answers and assigned answers for the assignment questions. It is a quality assignment. Another student, he does not take care. He writes something and submits as assignment. That assignment is in a shabby handwriting. It is in a shabby paper. The presentation is not good. Lot of spelling mistakes, lot of grammatical mistake. He does not take care even to properly punctuate the writings. Two assignments are parallelly submitted. One assignment is a good assignment, another assignment is a bad assignment. One assignment is a quality assignment, another assignment is a non-quality assignment. Now let us compare the cost of the two assignments. When you compare the cost of these two assignments, cost spent for two assignments is same. So in the first assignment, you are getting quality as free. So basically, one thing you have to understand, quality is the net result of your commitment to quality, your hard work, your mindset, the participation of the all stakeholders in the organization. Quality, for getting quality, we never spend more. Moreover, by delivering bad quality products to the society, society is spending more money. Because of that, it gets loss. That can be well understood by going through these explanations. Now, cost. If we take a quality cost, it is consisting of two things. One is cost of control, cost of confirmation. Cost of failure to control, cost of non-confirmation. So, what is the meaning of this is, for producing a quality product, we are checking in the production process itself whether the product is conforming to quality specification. For that money is spent, that is cost of control. Here we are having two types, one is prevention cost, another one is appraisal cost. Prevention cost is amount spent while manufacturing the product itself so that it deliver a good conforming product. Appraisal cost is amount spent on quality checks. In cost of failure to control, when a product fails inside the organization itself, you have to spend more money to correct it. It is internal failure cost. When a product fails in the market, that is in the hands of the customer, you have to spend more money. You have to send your service personnel to the customer's place. You have to settle that complaint. For that you will be spending money. That is external failure cost. So this is this cost plus this cost totally gives quality cost. So quality cost is sum of cost of conformance plus cost of failure to failure. That is also sum of prevention cost plus appraisal cost plus internal failure cost plus external failure cost. This is cost of quality. Then comes quality cost as a PAF model. Here, first you have to assess the prevention of the failure. You have to prevent, you have to spend money and prevent a non-quality product in the production stage itself. That is prevention cost. Then you have to check quality check. Amount spent on quality check is appraisal cost. So cost of failure is If your product fails internally, the cost of setting right the product internally is called as internal failure cost. The cost of the, when the product fails external into the, in the hands of the customer, where you go and set right the failure, that is external failure cost. So this is a PF model of cost of quality. Then hit and poor quality. Your product is having a poor quality. It is having many hidden costs. Not only sitting right. A customer is buying a product. The product fails within a 1 week. He purchases a generator. That generator fails within a 1 week. So the product gets failed in the hands of the customer. At that time, you have to send a service personnel to the customer's place. There he has to set right the mistake. And they, he has to hand it over again to the customer and he has to conduct a trial run and all. So the amount spent on that is much. That is one. Another one is, if a product fails in the market within 1 week, that the customer will be getting a bad opinion on the brand image of the product. Not only him, he will pass on that message to many other fellow customers. I had purchased the X brand generator. It had failed within a week. Like that, he will tell to 10 people. That 10 people will not prefer that brand in future. That is another hidden cost. Like that, if your product or your service failed externally, or if it is failed internally, it creates many hidden costs for the products. That is also called as hidden cost of poor quality. This gives a fairly good idea. It is a diagram of an ice floating on the water. Usually, when your ice floats on the water, only 1/3 will be visible, 2/3 will be under the water. That is a natural calculation. So, the cost of poor quality, only 1/3 of the cost of poor quality will be visible and 2/3 of the cost of poor quality will not be visible. This diagram is a self-explanatory for that. This is self-explanatory for this. Processing costs, warranty expenses, it is visible. Lost sales, process downtime, extra inventory, overtime in correcting errors, loss of goodwill, etc. All paperwork. This is a hidden cost of poor quality. Next is model for optimum quality cost. Now here it gives a solution for an important question in the minds. Shall we go for quality means, shall we have to produce a product which gives 100% customer satisfaction? Or we have to produce a product which will give 99% of the customer satisfaction? Or whether we have to produce a product which gives 90% of the customer satisfaction? Here one thing comes, naturally we want 10% customer satisfaction. But what happens is, whenever you started producing a product which gives 10% customer satisfaction, you have to spend more on quality. The quality cost will become more and more. Because of that, what happens is, the cost will be much more, but you will be delivering 10% customer satisfied products. But that is also not liked by the customers at large, because they want quality products, they want customer satisfaction in a bargainable cost. That is the order of the day. So this chart gives you a little bit better explanation how much customer satisfaction we have to deliver. Now you watch this. Here, this is the total quality cost. This is the failure cost. This is the cost of appraisal plus prevention. You want 10%. You want quality confirmed 10% means your cost will be like this. Total cost will be maximum. 10% will be maximum. And if you deliver 90%, it will be minimum. If you deliver 80%, again it will be maximum. So judicially, you have to select a point where the total quality cost is low. That point you have to identify. That point is the point where the total failure cost cut the total cost of appraisal. And if you project from that, you will be getting the lower. If you obtain that point and project it to the quality conformance, somewhere it will be crossing around 95 or 96% quality conformance. You adhere to that. That will be the most profitable to the company. Next comes basics concept in 2QM. A 2QM can be, this a TQM can be implemented only you follow these basic concepts. One is the management should be a committed and involved management. Second one, they have to be an unwavering focus on the customers, both internal and external customers. Thirdly, there should be an effective involvement by the management as well as the middle level and all the stakeholders. Fourthly, there should be continuous improvement in the business and the process plans. Then you have to treat the customer, the suppliers as the partners, and you have to establish performance measures for all the process, including production process and the business process. Next, a historical review of the historical review. In the historical review, this concept of quality had evolved right from the Stone Age. In the Stone Age, they had used sharp stone as the weapon to kill the customer. So at that time, if the sharp stone does not deliver the intended purpose, a man cannot kill the animal, the animal will kill the man. That is the situation. From that day itself, the concept of quality is understandable by human beings, even though that word quality was not there. That sharpened stone should deliver its intended purpose. Otherwise, it will not kill the animal. If the sharpness is not proper, the animal will not get killed. Automatically, injured animal will kill the human beings. So, it is implied that right from the Stone Age, before the coming of any language, before the coming of any application of iron metals, the concept of quality had evolved. Then, formally, in 1924, Shivat in Bell Telephone Company had first made a quality approach. He is given an approach on quality in 1920, so we will be calling him as a father of quality. And in the same time, this Dodge and Roaming, in from the same Bell Telephone Companies, they had created acceptance sampling plans. In 1946, American Society of Quality, which is famously abbreviated as ASQ, was formed. Nowadays, it is the same society also existing as on date also. In 1915 onwards, Edwards Deming and M. Juron started practicing quality through by their series of lectures. And all Japanese industries widely followed their lectures. This is the basic reason for the success of the Japanese industries. Because of this total quality management concept, because of practicing this total quality management concept, Japanese industries overrided American industries in the world market in 1980s and 1970s. This is the sole reason. Technological advancement is not the reason. If we take the technological advancement of the Americans, is much more than Japanese. But even though they are little bit lagging in the technological advancements, in the world business, they had beaten Americans because of practicing total quality management. That is also understood by American peoples and Europeans, and later stages in 80s, later 80s and later 90s, all Americans and Europeans, they also started practicing this total quality management concept. Next is, from late 1980s, automobile companies emphasized on statistical quality control. Then in 1996, automotive, they created the concepts of customer satisfaction. In 1990s, a concept of International Standards Organization and ISO 9000 quality systems are evolved. Then later ISO 14000 quality system, concentrating on environmental management system and all evolved. This is in these steps the quality concept had evolved in the international platform. Now, the status of quality, cost, delivery. If you take any service, if you take any purchase of products, internationally, these three things always played a role. One is quality of the product purchased, adhering to delivery schedule, adhering to the cost. So, in 1960, people does not worry about delivery and quality. They had worried about only cost. In 1980, they had worried about only delivery, not the quality and cost. In 1990, they had worried about only the quality, not the cost and delivery. But in 2000, again, the same thing had evolved in 2000. But one change. In 1960, they worried about cost, but they didn't worry about delivery and quality because they don't insist any delivery schedule or any quality standard. But in 2000, delivery and quality are imperative. They are indispensable. They want best quality, they want in-time delivery, at the same time, they want low cost. That is in 2000. So, this is the international scenario in 2000 and after. Even Asante, we want low cost, not at the cost of delivery and quality, but low cost with ensured delivery schedule and ensured quality. This is Asante, international customers' requirement. I hope that with this, a broad introduction on TKM has been delivered. And this will, if you go through this and if you refer a standard textbooks, you will be getting a right information and you will be getting a right idea what is TKM is. Thank you.